Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Brett Norman YouTube channel and other channels. Today on our Sabbath meeting, this Saturday, March 28, 2020, where we are meeting together with Michael and Yerk, both on the Satanic Media Agenda Exposed. And today, unlike our normal sessions, I would like to especially ask that we consider the difficult task of what it means to be a born-again Christian today. That we have been born in the flesh in this world, and through the Spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ, He has introduced us to the Spirit. The Spirit being Jesus Christ in the form of His love and His comfort to us in His realm, in His due season, and not in ours. So we are to die to self. We are to die to our own conscience in that sense, and let Christ's conscience be part of us, and to lay down our expectations and our wishes upon this life and hand it over to Christ. And in that, we might find some fellowship with others. And I believe that is the spirit that we're gathered in today. And I'm very grateful to have my friends in Europe that are paying very close attention to the signs of the times that we live today and are willing to do the studies and are willing to ask the tough questions, because it's, not getting any easier for the life in the flesh. And this is what's going to happen, I believe, in this day and age. We're definitely going to face some tougher times. And we're hoping that these sessions will help us all to prepare in the Spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to thank Michael for putting together these papers and doing these sessions. And I want to thank Yerk for all of his disciplined work in doing the readings throughout all these years. And we're going to start out with some scripture today, and Yerk's going to read for us. Yerk, welcome.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the introduction, Brett, and welcome, Michael. So we decided to start with a reading of the King James Version, of course, of the book of Revelation, chapter 8. And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And the seven angels, which had the seven trumpets, prepared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth. And the third part of the trees was burned up, and all green grass was burned up. And the second angel sounded, and as it was a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died. And the third part of the ships were destroyed. And the third angel sounded. And there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood. And many men died of the waters, because they were made bitter. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld, and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jörg, for reading the Revelation chapter 8. It is here that we have got together here for this gathering, that we are talking about a satanic media agenda, which is does not only consist of songs, which does not only consist of lyrics, but on the other hand consists of visual influences, consists of films, of movies, of television adverts, of everything, of short films, of everything you can imagine, for even for youngsters, for children, Nickelodeon. Every time you are being influenced, big scale, because there are so many references to symbols, so many references to paganism, so many references to just the material world, all in line to have the message spread that you are just a material being, like Madonna once said in I'm just a material girl in a material world. So there is nothing spiritual of it. Yeah, nothing spiritual left. They are just, men are being taught, or mankind is being taught, that they are just, flesh and bones. Yeah, for example, Human League has once had a hit in the early 80s, so it's called Human. I'm only human, of flesh and blood I'm made. So where's the spirit there? Where is the spirit? This is a trick of the Antichrist, that they tries to convince you that you are just flesh and bones, and you have to just fulfill your material needs. You just have to eat, drink, sleep, and to multiply, to have sexual intercourse, and maybe some fun while doing the sports. But don't ever think. Don't ever use your own brain. Don't get connected to the Holy Spirit. It's highly dangerous. And so all these influences we come across with these so-called artists are being made to simply convince us that it's futile, but because it's everything but materialism in the world. In the world of the Antichrist, everything is materialism. And if you want to achieve the biggest, the highest position there, you're a very wealthy person. And you're not only wealthy person, but you are a very influential person. So it's all about the media agenda, being a medium for Satanism, which is, of course, the Antichrist. There are just two groups. There's one is the Spirit of Christ, which is the Holy Spirit, because Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of the Almighty God. And on the other hand, it's the Antichrist spirit, which was already in the world when Jesus Christ was walking on the earth. So that does mean that there will be no Antichrist spirit revealed in later times, but it just was 2,000 years ago present, and it still is, of course. And that's everything according to media means that these people, these artists, actors, writers, theater agents, whatever, are all mediums to spread the agenda. Because you see that actually also a movie, we did come across the fact that Phil Collins, for example, played a part in Miami Vice and several movies like Buster. These movies actually are fake. Why are they fake? I have prepared a lecture in German soon. I have not translated it in English yet. But a movie is still fake because a movie is a fake impression of several numbers of single pictures being put together so fast that your eye thinks, believes, has illusion, it's an illusion, yeah, that this is a real movement happening. And this is called a movie because of moving. Yeah, so something is moving there, but still a film is a combination and a follow-up of single pictures. So every movie is an illusion. It's just all an illusion. That we have to face the fact that we are being betrayed because our eye can only cope with the several amount of images per second, which is, I think, about the frequency, so which means the number of events taking place in at the same time per minute is about 25 to 30, if I remember well. And if you are then have a so-called movie with the frames per second, so with different pictures per second, then your eye thinks, oh, it's not a single thing, but it's a flowing, it's in a flow, it's a fluent thing, and it's a movie because I can see the seamless, the fluent motion of a sports driver or whatever.
By the way, Michael, if I may interrupt you there, there was a song in 1982 by a British trio called Imagination. It's just an illusion.
Yeah, that's correct. Yes. It's all an illusion. Because you see, this I have, as I told you, I have prepared a 600 pages document in German, at least, on this whole media thing. But we cannot do it today because, you see, I was not prepared to do that. But it's just to have a proper introduction into this, because now we are getting away from the lyrics of David Bowie, as interesting they might be, but we're going into the movies, because actually he was also a movie character. He made several movies and he starred in several movies. For example, Good Morning, Mr. Lawrence, with the music from Richiichi Sakamoto, which also was teaming up together with Iggy Pop. And we know Iggy Pop from David Bowie also. So you see that everybody is in touch with them. And today I would like to now take over to the next movie that David Bowie starred in, which is not that famous. For example, it was also not that prominent. It was not that successful. It did not hit the charts big time. But it's again David Lynch, Twin Peaks, Fire Walk With Me, which is a kind of explanation, which came after the television series, but intended to have the explanation what did happen before the murder of Laura Palmer, which is depicted here on top of that poster. And you see here four guys below of that. That's, for example, that's Kyle MacLachlan, Miguel Ferrer, Kyle MacLachlan. Oh, I think the white hand, the white glove is quite appropriate here. And then David Lynch, the director, and David Bowie. And you see, this man here is casted for a special reason, because he actually fits perfect for the role he was then portraying. And he's
Aren't
also
they all specially casted? I mean, when you think of Kyle MacLachlan, he was the main actor in Dune.
Yeah,
that sci-fi movie about where there is a sci-fi Jesus, like you have in Matrix. Yeah, you have Miguel Ferrer, who was the main actor in The Stand from Stephen King, 6-part, 9-hour television movie they made out of that, The Stand, which, by the way, is about a virus that breaks out of a labo of a laboratorium and kills most all of mankind. Interesting enough in these times that we are living in. So I think there's much more to it than you see on the first glance of that photo.
A coincidence theory.
Coincidence means actually cooperating incidents. It doesn't have to mean a incidence that is all by without any purpose. No, there most of the times is a purpose behind quote unquote coincidences.
Yeah, you see, and also David Bowie is the only one who's wearing a white jacket. Yeah, so they're all federal types, and on the left side they are supposed to represent the Federal Bureau, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the FBI. Yeah, correct. Yeah, and he's he's the lonely ranger, whatever. He's the one who is then
Church and state, Michael. the black guys is the state, and the white guy is the spirit, and that's the spiritual power. And then there you have church and state combined together, the dream of the Roman Catholic Church for the world government.
Yeah, and he's also been portrayed here as a kind of loony, lunatic, whatever. And we will go into that because I've said before that he was casted. He was casted. Before that, we have also explained to our listeners in the previous episode that he was highly influenced and has highly influential roots from the white, so-called white witch. There are no witches, a witch is a witch is a witch. And which is now we are going into the next picture. Explaining that, Fire Walk With Me trailer. I don't know if Brad is used to that. I don't think so. Yeah, this is just a picture in a television, of a television. And every time a television is being shown in the movie, then it's a television. So it's a vision that somebody sees something, and this is a kind of a window. Yeah, you see that everything is a kind of window. It is no coincidence that the major Microsoft software has been called Windows because it opens the gate or it opens the doors or opens the windows to another dimension, which we haven't had before. Yeah, before Windows, there was no such comfortable tool as long as it goes for the Microsoft world. So, and that's which you see the main figure here, Carly McNaghton, the FBI agent, and David Bowie getting behind him. That's not the big deal. The big deal comes now. Yeah, the big deal is that this character David Bowie is portraying here is a kind of a, he disappeared for 2 years. Yeah, and this is portrayed by David Bowie, which has highly occult experiences and also was for several periods of his life under the heavy influence of drugs, mainly cocaine. Yeah, and you see here the picture where he is displayed sitting or whatever, kneeling on the stairs. He's coming from above, actually. Yeah, he's coming from above. You see, he's someone coming from above down to earth, if we would use it in Peter Gabriel terms. And you see that behind him, it's a black smoke, a black cloud, whatever. And this is not a coincidence. So that everywhere where he's approaching, he's carrying something with him. Yeah, you see that could be a reference to some kind of shadow following him. Yeah, because it's just a black thing behind him. Yeah, so he's been followed by something, and everywhere he's been going, he leaves his mark, or he leaves a kind of destruction. And we see it's not a happy thing here. It's not kind of a happy face. Yeah, he's looking actually very depressed, very whatever. Yeah, but it's not a happy movie at all. It's about murder. Yeah, and he has severe pain. He's got also some kind of incidence here on his lip, whatever. And you see that he's portraying a very strange character. Yeah, again, he's been wearing white. White is the color of spirit. White is the color of purity. White is the color of innocence. That's why the bride is always in white, because she's so innocent. Yeah, okay, that's so far for the sarcasm here. And he was absent for 2 years. And now you see some kind of interference here. It's a picture-in-picture depicting here a male character wearing red and black. It's the color of Satanism. And it's been layered on top of the actual picture here. So it's a picture-in-picture, and this is molded together here. And you see this is the reference for Satanism, something of the dark spirit. And you see that the dress is appropriate, a mask. He's wearing a mask with a long nose, maybe whatever. Yeah, but he's wearing here something which could be stand for a voodoo cult. Yeah, this is actual figure. And I made a reference then when I did the lecture in German with Jörg. I made the reference here with Pinocchio. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Brett, I don't know how famous Pinocchio mm-hmm. is in the United States, but at least as far as...
So when Pinocchio lies, he's not telling the truth. His nose grows.
Yes,
and it gets
correct.
Longer and longer and longer and longer.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's an interesting reference, because you see that this is actually a Walt Disney movie. Yeah, so it must be famous in some kind of way in the United States. And I made the reference here because you see in the last picture, you see he has got a very long nose. It stands for a lie. Yeah. Yeah, so it's really no coincidence that Pinocchio now here has a normal nose, and then his nose is growing and growing and growing because he's always lying and lying and lying and deceiving the people. And it's not a positive character in any way, and it's great that we have a satanic media agenda here, because the satanic media agenda actually started here in the case of Pinocchio in 1940. That's 80 years ago. 80 years ago. And there's also another movie called Pinocchio, the Puppet of Death. Yeah, why there is a hammer on the right side of the picture with blood. Why there's a hammer? Yeah, you see, because Pinocchio kills an animal with a hammer. So Pinocchio actually is a murderer. He killed someone or something, an animal. It's supposed to be a film for a movie for children, supposed to be. Yeah? And she reappears, the animal reappears as a ghost. Yeah, that's quite appropriate for David Bowie, because he reappears 2 years later because he was disappeared. He's portraying a former FBI agent. Yeah, and he is reappearing. So very much coincidence with Pinocchio. Yeah, you see, that's the problem here. You see that he is not an easy character. You see in this picture again. Yeah, this is a layer, and you see here two different faces. This is the actual face, and behind that or beside that, it's a very desperate face here, open mouth. Closed eyes, yeah. A little bit blurred image, yeah. And don't be fooled by the Christian cross or so-called Christian cross. There are no Christian crosses and there are no Christian symbols anyway. Yeah, that's the thing with the long nose. So long nose stands for lying. And where do we know lying from? Yeah, not only from the Tarot, because in the Tarot you see that lying, of course, you can look it up, read in John 8:44, that I know from memory, that Satan has been called the father of lies. And actually he was. The first lie in the Bible which we came across to is the lie of the serpent telling Eve, oh, no. Did God really said, you will surely not die? So Satan is the father of lies, and Satan is also the symbol for Pinocchio, because Pinocchio must also be a good liar because his nose is that long, and he kills someone. He kills someone or something. Yeah, he kills an animal in the movie supposed to be watched by children. Great, huh? Great. You see that if you look down to the tarot card number 6 here, yeah, you see the lovers here on the left side, supposed to be Eve, on the right side supposed to be Adam, of course. You see, there's a serpent, the modern way of serpent as we know a serpent or a snake. We see a tree with fruits. We see some kind of divine being with wings. We see some clouds, so it's above the clouds, it's in the sky. Lucy in the sky. Yeah, there, just the diamonds are missing here. Okay, so on the right side here, you see the card number 15. Here is a downside pentagram, which stands for Satanism. This is the horned one. And actually, you see now, female and male also carry horns, and they are being changed, so they are being enslaved in bondage by Satan. And you see here some kind of fire. Yeah. The lovers, the devil. That's just tarot card. There are several tarot decks. It's a smaller, the little arcana, which means the secret, and the big arcana. And there are numerous decks with the several illustrations from several people. But I just wanted to point out that also the story of the Bible is depicted here in some kind, shape, or form in the tarot cards. Yeah. So they all have to act according to the Bible. That's my point. And you see here in the hand, in the left hand path, yeah, in the left hand of the devil, it's called the devil, the card, for obvious reasons. He's carrying a torch. Okay? Moving on. Yeah, you see that this is Le Diable or Diabolo. Jörg just mentioned the car manufacturer Lamborghini with his model Diablo. It's called the Lamborghini Devil, of course. Now, Diable, Diablo, these are different languages, Spain, Latin, Italian, whatever. Yeah, and you see, this, it's the same reference here. Yeah, it's the same reference here. They are bound to the devil, yeah, because as long as there are in human form, in this material world, ask Madonna, they are being played by Satan, which is, I think, which is, you see also a torch here, and this is really a nice dragon wing, isn't it? And nice goat horns and the pentagram. That you see that if you come across these things, yeah, you will see that it is not a mockery of the Bible, because they have to make a reference to the Bible, because actually the problem is that they can only act on behalf of the Bible. They can only act as the adversary of the Almighty God. Why is that? Yeah, because the Almighty God is Almighty. And so there is no script number B or number two or number beta. There is just one script, and the script is in the Bible. It's in the book of Revelation. It's the last script of the Bible. And this is to be fulfilled. There is no alternative to that. It doesn't make no sense to claim, oh, we would be better off doing this, or maybe we could change that. No, there is no other way. There is also no other way for Satan, or his followers, or his angels, or whomsoever. There is no other way, but there is just one script for the since the beginning of the world. It's the Almighty God who knows what will happen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And if you are the first and the last, so you know the script from the beginning to the very end. Okay, going into this movie now. You see, this is the official from the Lynchnet, from the director of the movie, the script from Fire Walk With Me, FWWM script. Yeah, I'm not making anything up. I'm not supposed to be. I'm not allowed to, according to the Ninth Commandment. So this is just here that we are now here in the script, not of the Bible, but of this measly film, of course. Yeah, you see, that is, I can prove anything which is happening here. Yeah, and you see that There is some strange things occurring there, and I have made up a video which Brad did not look at already, but I think that concerning that, I hope it can be displayed in the United States or in the English speaking countries. I would love to introduce it or to insert it at this moment, so you can get an idea what's it all about. So please enjoy the little take from Fire Walk With Me.
Talk about Judy. In fact, we're not going to talk about Judy at all. We're going to keep her out of it.
I found something!
Who do you think this is then?
What the hell did he say there, Albert? That's Special Agent Dale Cooper. For God's sakes, Jeffries, where the hell have you been? You've been gone down here 2 years.
It was a dream. We live inside a dream.
And it's raining post toasties.
Hell, God, baby, damn, no! I found something in Seattle at Judas. And then there they were. And they sat quietly for hours. And I followed. Ring.
The owls are not what they seem.
Okay, now you saw that there are some strange things happening because David Bowie, as the agent, is using a very strange term here. And we are going into that now. I've explained enough, I hope, in the movie. But you see that he's shouting here. Jeffries, this is the supposed Philip Jeffries. This is supposed to be David Bowie. He's shouting. You see his mouth wide open in the FBI room. Hail God by every damn no. And I'm pointing out that he's not meaning hell God, but hell God. That's my explanation for that. Yeah. And in the script, which is very interesting, especially this line is missing. In the complete script, this line is missing. So it could mean two things. Either the director doesn't want you to know, but it has been displayed, so it cannot be. But the other thing is that he made it just out of the blue. Yeah, it was his idea to use that on that very term, on that very scene here. Yeah, that's the problem. That's the problem here. You see that he's coming up with something which is not standing in the script, and I found that very interesting. That every time someone is telling something which is not in the script, it means something very personal to him, to David Bowie. And this is here, because he's saying here, no, I found something in Seattle, at Seattle, it's very interesting, Brett, huh? Seattle, at Judy's. And then there were whatever, yeah? And this everything is not interesting for me. And here it's intercourse between two worlds. Yeah, of course, it's the material world and the spiritual world. And you see, that's the thing. Why does he come up with hell God by every damn no? I can explain that. At least I can explain the explanation of David Bowie. Yeah. So, hell God, baby, damn no, I found something. This is from an official site here. No spoilers. There are even cups here with that very quote. Okay, where does it come from? Haha. You know that everybody knows everyone? It's coming from Adrian Belew. It's supposed to come from him. Yeah. So Adrian Belew, who's Adrian Belew, by the way, yeah, he said that during the touring days, so he's a musician, 78 to 79, he's coming up with that phrase. And he must have any connection to David Bowie, so that David Bowie used the exact same phrase about 10 years later. So Adrian Belew does make music on his own, but... yeah, of course, also with David Bowie, but so they got in touch. But he was a member of the band King Crimson. Oh, King Crimson again. Don't we know King Crimson from Peter Gabriel? So you got already now the connection: King Crimson, Peter Gabriel, Robert Fripp, Wally Elmlack, Mark Bolan, Jimi Hendrix, and it goes on and on and on now. So Belew, is Adrian Belew guy, was the second guitarist at the King Crimson band. And also he was offered to play at a Talking Heads album. And he decided to do King Crimson. And also this guy was founding another band with a level 42 bassist called Marking, the man with the slap bass. And the Police drummer Stuart Copeland, a new band called Gizmodrome. On the left side, you see the guitar type from Mark King. Can you imagine where he got his talent from? I don't know if you are familiar with the band Level 42. Of course, it has a reference to the book of Per Anhalter durch die Galaxie, The Hitchhiker's Guide to Galaxy, where the big machine, the big computer, the main computer has been asked, oh, what is the solution of everything in this universe? And the computer says, simply just says, oh, it's 42. So this is his supposed to be reference why he's calling this band Level 42. Okay, and Stuart Copeland, you have to know that guy, because I will soon make a small session about the Police. Don't underestimate the Police. Yeah, so this is just King Crimson. You see Robert Fripp together with Peter Gabriel here.
Do you have any idea if this Copeland, what was his name there?
Can you Stuart scroll Copeland. Up a
little? Stuart yeah. Copeland is family mm-hmm. of Kenneth Copeland?
No, I don't know that, but I won't. I have another reference. I know where he is coming from.
Ah, okay.
I don't know if I shall reveal that, but I can tell you that his father is CIA.
Stuart Copeland's father.
Yeah.
Aha.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
It's just next. It's just does
coincidence.
Not. Coincidence, yeah.
Yeah, right.
I came across that a few days ago. I said, no, not again. Yeah.
Ah, no wonder. Hmm.
You know that Police made also a movie, because but the band Police, most people think, oh yeah, Sting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but actually Stuart Copeland founded the Police. He was the major force behind that.
Ah, yes.
And the Police also you underestimate Stuart Copeland. And you see that the main figure in the spotlight was always Gordon Sumner, called Sting for some reason. And you see that the Police made a song in the early 80s called Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic, and more interesting, We Are Spirits in a Material World. So they cannot be friends with Madonna. Hmm? Because Madonna just says we are I'm a material girl in a material world, and then the Police is contradicting that and say no, we are spirits in a material world. Yeah, this is very interesting, because you see that I think we have to make an excerpt here of about 2 minutes, because if you look it up here, the lyrics, spirits in the material world, not to spoil anything of the a Police session coming someone another point of time, but you have really to look at that up. There is no political solution to our troubled evolution. So this is a major fault in the second line already, because there is no evolution. Have no faith in constitution. There is no bloody revolutions. We are spirits in a material world. Our so-called leaders speak with words that try to jail you. You see, this is about 30 years, 35, 37, 38 years ago.
Quite fitting for the corona time we live in now, eh?
Yeah. That's why I'm showing it to you. They subjugate the meek, but it's the rhetoric of failure. Where does the answer lie? Living from day to day, if there's something we can't buy, there must be another way. We are spirits in the material world. I know that Sting is just the alter ego of Gordon Sumner, wrote that song. Yeah. But it's nevertheless, yeah, this is, I think this goes for the entire period of mankind. Yeah, this is sophistry and casuistry here. Okay, going back to David Bowie or Robert Fripp or King Crimson or whomever, Adrian Bewley, you see these guys know each other.
You know that Adrian Blue here in the United States is pronounced blue, as in the color blue.
Okay.
And he was a very influential musician along with Peter Gabriel. representing the progressive scene. I went to see a King Crimson concert in Seattle back in 94, I want to say, or was it 95? I think it was 95, actually. And yeah, interesting stuff.
Do you know her?
Ah, Kate Bush.
Yeah, she's related to Robert Fripp. She's related to David Bowie. And she didn't know of Wally Ermlock, huh? You see, these people are being together for days or weeks when they are recording the sessions. Yeah, for hours and days and maybe weeks. They all are connected. They all know each other. You see that it does not make if you have the stories of so many musicians, then you see there are several things connected there. And it's also always the same. It's always the same. You see, King Crimson, we did deal with that fact on the Peter Gabriel sessions. And so I don't have to do it quite again. Yeah, the gardener plants an evergreen, which is, of course, a reference of Nimrod. Yeah. And also it's connected to Emerson, Lake and Palmer. Yeah, Greg Lake is connected to King Crimson and Emerson, Lake and Palmer. Greg Lake is King Crimson and the lake of Emerson, Lake and Palmer. Fanfare for the common man? Anyone. It's very famous instrumental. Okay, going further on. This is always the script. I have to skip it now a little bit because I don't want to go very deep into that. But you see that I've showed you the movie. Yeah, I've showed you the movie, and you see that he's been depicted as a man having nightmares, having a spiritual experience, and he's a lunatic. And actually, he's playing himself. Yeah. You can only be a good actor when you are playing yourself. And in one scene, this is a German version here, in one scene, the spirit called Bob, B-O-B, it's a word or it's a name which you can read from the beginning to the end or from the end to the beginning. You see that if you would split the O in two, in a half here, yeah, you got a mirror image. Yeah, you can. It's the same thing from the one direction as it is from the other direction. There's a circle of fire appearing in the room. Yeah, circle of fire is a pagan religion. It's a sacrifice. It's a so-called protection circle. It can be anything. But in the Bible, it is not allowed to let your children go through the fire. So fire is always destruction. Okay.
Could it also be a reference to the lake of fire? Come walk with me. Satan, you know, he wants his worshipers to join him in the lake of fire. So,
yeah, it's always the reference that to be consumed with fire.
Mm-hmm. You also have Johnny Cash, Ring of Fire.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you see that it's every time the same here because David Bowie is also making here the main entrance song for the move for called "I'm Deranged," and this "I'm Deranged" song has been written by David Bowie together with Brian Eno. Brian Eno, anyone? Don't you know Brian Eno?
Oh yeah.
Brian Eno once was a member of Roxy Music. In the early
Brian 70s. Eno is a member of King Crimson, correct?
He has been a member of several bands, but he has been prominent to do his own thing and to be a producer. Also, he's connected to Peter Gabriel.
Right.
Yeah. Right. So you got the same ties here. You got the same ties all over.
And to you too, for that matter. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. It's Daniel Langlois who produced most of the U2 things. But of course, they all know each other and they all can help out each other. Yeah. It's a clique. Yeah. It's a circle of their own. These are artists and they have to make it big time. So they will help each other out. And not only with inspiration. Yeah, including the song has been written here in 1995 on the album Outside. including the appearance of an angel figure before an artist. So two different edits were featured in the film Lost Highway in 1997. I cannot recommend to watch the entire movie because it's highly complicated for anyone who's not in the spirit. If we agree on the fact, all three of us, that there are two lines here, yeah, you see that according to Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between your seed and her seed. Yeah, there are two seeds, and we could also say there are two spirits: the spirit of Christ, which is the Holy Spirit, and the spirit of Antichrist. And the people who are in the spirit of Antichrist are the people who are born out of flesh and not out of spirit. Of course, they only see what they are supposed to see, or they only see what they comprehend. And they see the movie with their eyes, and they cannot get it, because they don't see the dimension of the movie. They just see the movie as is, but they don't see the real meaning behind any movie. And that's the real problem behind it. So that movies are to entertain the people. So to enter in the mental state, enter meant, there is tain missing, entertain meant. Yeah, it's to enter and to tain the mental state of the viewer. And David Bowie, he's one of the most prolific and talented in quote unquote talented or quote inspired unquote directors of all time, because he can make a plot so twisted that no one gets it except him, or except the people who are getting used to that kind of thinking, because they know that David Lynch makes everything out of his inspiration. And if you look at his films, at his movies, it's all about murder, it's about complications. There is just only one movie which David Lynch made, which is quite nice, and he did it also for Disney. And this is a movie about a farmer who visits his ill brother, and he was on a lawnmower, had to drove on a lawnmower for, I think, 300 or 400 miles across the United States. And this is the actual story. This is help me out, Brett. Don't you know the movie? The Straight Story. Yeah, I really loved that film. Yeah, I really loved that film, and it's not typical for David Lynch. But all the other films, Blue Velvet and Twin Peaks and Mulholland Drive, Lost Highway, it's all thrillers. It's all about sex, crime. Yeah, you don't make these movies if you're on the Jesus Christ spirits. If you're on the Jesus Christ spirit, you don't make any movies. At least not in a big way, in a prominent way, because you're not allowed to, of course, because all the material things are being under the rulership of Satan. So this is a movie from 1997. Now the song was used as an intro and an outro. Okay, so we are not going into the movie so far, but because the problem is that...
Say, Michael, can I make a comment?
Every time.
Yeah, so just to be sure, what Michael just said about moving pictures and about making videos and things like this, I just want to add that, you know, The most important thing we can do is educate each other into our faith and what we believe to be true, and that is that Christ died to save us from our sin, and that if we do make these videos and presentations, they are out of love and respect to help others climb out of the pit that we have fallen into. And that's it.
Yeah, thank you for the statement. When I'm thinking about the fact of Jesus Christ, I'm quite convinced at this moment that Jesus Christ does not only come to save the mankind. Because you see that he was asked if he could do any miracles. And he said that this generation will not be shown any miracles. And I think that's because of the fact that you see that if people do not believe that Jesus Christ has come from the Almighty God, yeah, then what should? Yeah, you see that there is no other sacrifice, or there is no other big thing that the Almighty can come up with, but sacrificing his only begotten Son for mankind. Yeah, why do you need any wonders when you have the testified story of Jesus Christ from so many people? Now, why should he use any wonders or any miracles or whatever if you don't believe in Jesus Christ in the first place? Yeah, that's the only one condition, to have faith in Jesus Christ and faith in the Almighty God. Yeah, that's, I think that he did not die in, of course he did not die in vain, but you see that how shall God show his love to mankind more than sacrificing his own son, only begotten son, for the faith of for mankind. Jörg has put up his microphone. Oh yeah, no. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's all about believing in Jesus Christ or not. It's Christ or Antichrist. If you're Antichrist, you're against Christ. It's so easy. It's all about Jesus Christ. The name Antichrist tells it all. It's Antichrist. It's not anti-God. It's Antichrist. It's against Christ. It's against Jesus Christ. So the main figure was, is, and always will be Jesus Christ. You can mock every religion out there. Oh, you will be, no? Yeah, but it's you're not allowed to do that. But if someone is mocking Jesus Christ, oh yeah, well that's no big deal. You have to get used to that. No? Do that to another god, then it's then you're a racist or whatever, or you're a blasphemer or whatever. But if you do it to Jesus Christ, no.
Well, that's true. And, you know, that's how Satan works. He's very subtle about it. And he replaces the doctrine of Christ subtly, not in your face, you know, by getting people to do all of this mockery in the name of Satan under the banner of Christ, if that makes any sense. In a sense, they replace Christ with a replacement for Christ, Antichrist. So it's not really, it's actually for Christ, but yet against Christ in doctrine, if that makes any sense at all. It's like trying to go through all of your thoughts and make sure that you're not maintaining any kind of cognitive dissonance in your own thoughts. And if you know what cognitive dissonance is, it is a type of, how would you say this? An Ouroboros, you know, you have the serpent eating its own tail. It's the same with us. If we are doing something, we hold beliefs that are contrary to what we want to believe. Okay, let's put it that way.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, go ahead. Please.
Yeah, you see that the Ouroboros actually is also a symbol for eternity, because it consumes its very tail. Yeah, the problem with this is there is no eternity if you don't believe in Jesus Christ. So that's another lie of the serpent. Of course, the serpent is the Ouroboros.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. So that's why it's such a outrageously silly symbol to be using for anything at all.
You know, actually, this symbol depicts a biblical phrase, a biblical quote, because this Ouroboros symbol actually depicts that you will surely not die, lie from the serpent.
Uh-huh. Or the number eight,
yeah, which has also been used for the eternity. Yeah, there will be no eternity if people are accepting the serpent instead of Jesus Christ, accepting the creation instead of the creator. You see, imagine yourself, Brad and Jörg, imagine yourself that people are following men or women, what else? Yeah, and think, oh, they are so smart, and they are. I'm following their rules. I lead my life according to their regulations, whatever. Yeah. Did you ever recall that? How can we name then Krishna or Bhagwan or Helena Petrova Blavatsky or what else? Yeah, has been walked on water, or that the wind has been put to silence after he spoke? Or did someone of them raise the dead? But instead of that simple thinking, people following people because they only follow what they see. Because why is it? In my humble opinion, because they are of the flesh and they are not of the spirit.
Yep, that's it, Michael. That's it in a nutshell. Because if we were truly of the Spirit, we would be asking God in private through prayer.
Yeah, that's it.
All things. All things. Yeah. We wouldn't consult man at all.
You see, if we are talking to someone in the Spirit, we don't have to make all the sessions and we don't have to use any episode because he could see that for themselves. But there are, I think, a number of people who are really getting more and more and more curious about the things which are happening on this earth.
Sure.
I have avoided to use the word planet because planet is actually a wrong word for the earth. But you see that here, if you look at that picture here, I'm sharing the picture here, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Of these two poor people somewhere in whatever, India, Pakistan, I don't know. Yeah. This is also a lost highway. Lost means it's really lost. It's going into the unknown, or it's abandoned. There are not many people. It's lost. Yeah, so do you want to be on a lost highway? I surely don't. Yeah, and you see, that's just a picture here which tells you that there are so many inhabitants of the earth at the moment where you as a human being living in the United States or wherever are far more better off than them. We don't have to use the latest smartphones or the newest video games or whatever, or the nicest meal. There are so many people walking on that earth in that moment who are being betrayed and who cannot listen to any episode or cannot read any book because they cannot read. Can you imagine what state you are in when you cannot read? This is happening in the 21st century, people. That people cannot read, that people don't have enough to eat, don't have enough to feed their families. How can that be? Only except when you accept that we're living in a satanic world, where only one is caring for himself and not for others, as Jesus Christ was ordaining, love thy neighbors as yourself. If this would be the word of Jesus Christ, then these people would be properly dressed. These people would then have a nice home. These people would have a good education. Yeah. Yeah, this is the reference here in Matthew 10:5. Yeah, it's the street of the heathen. Yeah, it's a lost highway because it don't lead to heaven. It doesn't lead to heaven. I'm not speaking of the two people I just showed before, but you see that you have to go onto the narrow path and not on the broad way. And the narrow path is the path of Jesus Christ.
Here, I can read that quick if you want.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I would love to.
Matthew 10, verse 1. all the way to Matthew 10, verse 8, is it? So here we go. And we had called unto him his 12 disciples. He gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these. The first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Lebbaeus, whose surname is Thaddaeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give.
Yeah, thank you very much. So that everybody who believes in Jesus Christ is not on the lost highway. You see, the play of words here is not lost, but the highway. The highway to? Hell? Highway to Hell, AC/DC, anyone? So it's the highway which leads to somewhere above. Look at the type fonts here. Yeah, this is yellow on black surface. So we're looking into the black, into the darkness, into the unknown. We are on the street driving a car with two lights on, two light beams, like the eyes of something or whatever. The big thing now is this is in italics, some kind of italics, because the type fonts here is not in a straight line, but it's a little bit ascending. So it's the highway ascending from left to right. Okay. And there is another thing which is very obvious here, because the letters here are split in half. If you look at the G, it's completely split in half. Yeah. And this is just not the correct thing. Because you see that also this movie is about someone who has been mind splitting in half. It's about, I don't go into the psychological terms here because I'm not very used to do that, especially not in a foreign language like English to me. But you see, there are people who have several personalities inside. Yeah, I know that someone will come up with MK Ultra or something like that, but there are also some kind of schizophrenia and some kind of drug abuse and some kind of mental illnesses, and they're all coming out of the fact that the people that don't have are being led by the wrong spirit. Because if you are in the Holy Spirit, there is just one spirit. It's the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit. If you're affected by unclean or unholy spirits, there are numerous of them. We have learned that the third of the angels were cast down to earth by the tail of the red dragon in Revelation 12:3. So it's one against many. It's the same thing around as Jesus Christ against, or the followers of Jesus Christ against many opponents. It's always the majority which is in the spirit of the Antichrist. And to make a very profitable movie, you have to make movies for the people who are in the spirit of Antichrist. That's why most people go into the movies when there is murder, rape, fire, explosions, something's coming out, a threat coming out of the blue or coming out from aliens, whatever. Yeah. Can you imagine you show a movie about a little girl who was caring about her pony? How many people would go into that movie? I'm not speaking about the little girls now. how many of these so-called adults or educated people, let's say above the age of 21, would look at this movie where nobody is hurt, nobody is slaughtered, nobody is murdered, but just all is going to be well, and the pony gets a little bit ill, and then the little girl goes to the veterinarian doc, and he gets a little bit of treatment, and afterwards, the pony has another friend with another pony, and then they are going onto the green grass, and everything is fine. Yeah, it's boring for the people. Oh, no explosions, no murder, no rape, no naked women. No, I don't watch that movie. Because they are in the spirit of Antichrist. On the other hand, go like a movie like Armageddon. Yeah, totally explosion, and desperate and whatever. Yeah, slaughter. People watch that movie. Oh, it's highly sex. Yeah, of course. This is just a proof that we are living in the Antichrist, that we are living in the last days, that we are living in the spirit of the Antichrist. Look at the pictures. Look at the songs. Look at the lyrics. Yeah, what else? It can do 1,500 sessions on that. No problem. It's just to get the people aware who are maybe or were, I hope, maybe fans of David Bowie, David Lynch, Peter Gabriel, Phil Collins, whatsoever, to get really the thing sorted out, that this really is not usual, because you wouldn't want to live your life according the way that David Bowie lived it, with all the drugs, with all the abuse, with all that fornication. Yeah, this is the road to hell. This is a lost highway. Yeah, and I have prepared a video which Jörg doesn't know already, because it wasn't allowed to show it in the German Exodus episode, and Brett doesn't know it also because yeah. I haven't showed him. Yeah, but I have explained them in at least in German with subtitles what's going on. But we can do that to end the session. We can do that here in a kind of a dialogue, or in a kind of showing video capture frames. And then, you know, this is the difference between an explanation of a movie, if you are born out of the flesh or born out of the spirit. Because if you are born out of the flesh, you don't get that movie. You think, oh, this is just a dream or whatever. You don't see the dimension. You don't see it the spiritual way. And you have to see things the spiritual way, because this is all propaganda. This is all hidden meaning. This is the occult. This is people making fun of the people who are paying to be deceived. Paying to be deceived. In Germany, I don't know if it's also valid for the United States. In Germany, is it so? You have to pay some kind of a tax to watch television and to listen to the radio. You don't have to have a television set or a radio, but you are supposed to pay that. Otherwise, you would be fined. Yeah. So you're paying for your own manipulation. Okay, so his title track of David Bowie for that Lost Highway thriller, where a woman has been killed. How surprising. Is I'm deranged. And I'm deranged means I'm out of my mind. Yeah? The spirit is distorted in German here. Yeah? I'm out of his mind. But where are you when you are out of your mind? Yeah? You're in the mind of someone else, or you're on the lost highway, but you're out of your mind. You're deranged. Yeah, you see that normally it's arranged. Yeah? If you are having a train, and the train is going straight line, yeah, and now there's a distortion happening, an accident or whatever, then it's deranged, yeah. It's not in line. It's not according to the things which are supposed to go straight line from A to B. Yeah.
I think with a train that is called derailed.
Derailed. Oh, so yeah, it's derailed. Yeah, but it's the same explanation here, because it's not going the straight line. Yeah, if you are deranged, yeah, then you're in a state, in a mental state, which is not healthy and which is not the usual thing. So you're being affected by some other things mentally. Yeah. For example, entertainment. It's the same thing around. So we're going into that now. This is the lyric here. Funny how secrets travel. I start to believe if I were to bleed. Yeah. So here's a kind of sacrifice, some kind of a, illness, some kind of a pain. Yeah. The thin skies, the main chains his high, his hands held high. Cruise me blonde, cruise me blabe. A blonde belief beyond, beyond, beyond. Yeah, beyond what? Yeah. I'm deranged. No return. I'm deranged. I cannot get back. I'm deranged. And for example, if you take some psychological drugs, for example, LSD, yeah, this affects your mental state that you cannot go back to the state, to the original state. There will be side effects your entire life, sometimes. Sometimes not, but sometimes. So drugs is always a thing which is very, very, very important and very dangerous. Deranged, down, down, down. I'm deranged, down, down. Yeah, you see, he's coming from a mental state which is normal and he's going down, meaning it's getting worse. I don't have to use the quote of the lake of fire. Huh? It's the angel man. I'm deranged. Okay. So, this is here. The meeting of the so-called mystery man, portrayed by the actor Robert Blake, and Bill Pullman, which is the leading actor of The Lost Highway. If you look at this man, you see, he's also a little bit strange. He has a strange hairdress here. He's been like a split in half here. Yeah, he's constantly smiling. He has no eyebrows. His color is a bit pale. And he's approaching on the party the main leading actor, Bill Pullman, here. And Robert Blake, you see, he's not the average guy. He has been played in The Little Rascals. So he was a child actor in the 1940s. And he wasn't that happy also, because these are The Little Rascals. It's like Lauren Hardy and this kind of stuff, and Buster Keaton time, black and white, of course. Yeah. And the problem here with Robert Blake is that he was a decent actor. But the problem is here that after he made this film, he had very much bad luck. Bad luck on the major, major scale. And I don't know why it's not inserted here, but I can tell you anyway. He was accused of having murdered his wife, because his wife was found dead in his car. And he was filed to pay, I think, $20 million. And he was going bankrupt and he was accused. And so you see that portraying the other side, of portraying the dark side, will not make you happy in the long run. Yeah. And also in this movie, a German band called Rammstein is featured very prominently, because in that age of 1997, the band was not that prominent as they are now. And I have read yesterday that also the lead singer, Till Lindemann, is now coronavirus patient and corona tested positive. This is Rammstein. Rammstein, the name actually came from Rammstein with one M, which is a American army base in West Germany, or in Germany nowadays. And there was a flight accident, which you can see here with a collision, where 300,000 people have watched this flight show. And this is the band Rammstein. And Rammstein is very satanic. And even if people are coming across the German lyrics and know what they are singing, they don't care, actually, because the music is so stomping and aggressive and hard, and with a hard beat and with an aggressive rhythm guitar, etc. They also use pyro fireworks on a big scale on their concerts. I've seen one concert of them live in Berlin 1999, and they're using fireworks very extensively. So fire, Rammstein sings here, Rammstein, a man is burning. Yeah, meat smell is in the air. A child is dying. Sun is shining. A lake of fire.
just
come across that. I didn't recognize it in a German in a German episode, but it's a lake of fire, something like a lake of fire here. Mothers are screaming, etc., etc. This song is used in the movie Lost Highway. What a kind of movie it is. And this band is also prominent for another song, which is called To Play With Me. And Play With Me is about a brother asking his younger brother to play with him, on him. This is pedophilia. But people don't care. They are selling millions and millions of records. People are going to their concerts. It's pedophilia, but who cares? It's quite usual these days. We are living in the last days. We are living in Sodom and Gomorrah, or maybe worse. I don't know. But Jesus Christ says here in Mark 9:33, and in I don't know what it is here because it's 18 here. It's 9:33 and Luke 9. He's saying that about the childs. About the childs. In Mark 9:42, he's speaking of whoever sins. At this, you can read it. I think it's better to read it, Brett, in English. I cannot translate it.
Mark 9, verse
Mark 9:42, 6 to 9.
No, Mark 9:33 through 37. Luke 9:46 to 48. So in the Mark, on the above part, where it goes from 1 to 5, it says, Jesus called a child and put it in the midst of them, and he spoke, "Verily I say unto you, if you don't turn around and become like little children, you will not enter into the kingdom of God." Who now makes how do you say that? This word now is missing. Humbled. It was so nice translated. If you don't humble yourself, if you humble yourself like this child, he is the biggest he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And who takes a child like this in my name also takes me upon him. And then on Marcus 6 there it says, but who one of these little ones who believe in me gives them reason to sin, for him it was better that a big millstone was put around his neck and he was sunk into the depths of the ocean. See, this is how I can translate this here from German into English, but everybody understands that, okay? So in verse 7 it says, woe unto the man who comes to the sin.
And this is so that children have to be protected. And on the other hand, a German band called Rammstein makes a propaganda to fornicate with children. Nothing more, nothing less. Also Bon Jovi is using the code word Lost Highway because it's the highway for the lost souls, actually. And in this song Lost Highway, you see also the lyrics here. With my plastic dashboard Jesus. So Jesus has prominently been mentioned here in that song. You don't come across Jesus mentioned in a song very often, except by mocking. For example, you know Phil Collins or Genesis, Jesus, He Knows Me. Okay, and also there are other peoples who are using the term Lost Highway. But you see that we are going now into the Lost Highway thing. This is Lost Highway from, you know, that guy at his young age. He's always here on the Lost Highway. Turn it on, Mr. Turner. Who turns everything around? Who's the adversary turning everything around, trying to turn the world around? It's Satan. Turn it on, Mr. Turner, on the Lost Highway. Yeah, this, at least that's my explanation.
Oh, make your mama proud of you. Mm-hmm. Boy, yeah. Yes.
Build this road of sin. So now we know that the Lost Highway is always the road of sin. So it's the Broadway. Yeah. So this is here the little movie I have. I will insert here. And after that, we go into the dialogue, which is very interesting. Okay, I hope you got the picture or you got the movie. Yeah, you see, first of all, he's starting to drink something, and the drink can mean that he's doing some kind of drugs, because alcohol actually is a drug. And also you can, from alcohol, you can you can fall into delirium, especially, and you can get used to that alcohol. So you are, what is it, in if you are depending on alcohol, who's an American English term, Brad?
You're addicted.
You're addicted to the drug. So he's on the party with several people, and then he's taking a drug. He's not swallowing a pill, but he's taking here some kind of alcohol. So he's then in another state, and that's why the music then fades away. It's complete silence, and then out of the blue there is a deep dark bass tone, and bass tone is the lower frequency, and the lower frequency stands for the dark side, or everything which is below the surface. And the high frequencies, on the other hand, would stand for something which is in heaven. So if then the music comes in and you have here a very deep, big, loud tone, yeah, then it's like a growl of a monster or whatever, but it's to display that now the dark side is approaching, which is because in the next picture we see he's been approached by this so-called mystery man, which is no mystery to me. Okay, next picture. Yeah. We've been met before, haven't we? And Bill Pullman replies, I don't think so. Yeah? At your house, don't you remember? Now, the real meaning here is, I was inside your house. I was in your home. I was in you. I was there where you are living. I was in your living home. I was in your body. Okay, next picture. Of course. Yeah, I got the same wrong episode now here. This is not the correct time stamps here. Okay, so he's asking here why. We have met before in my house. And the mystery man tells him, as a matter of fact, I'm there right now. And Bill Pullman replies, what do you mean with there right now? And he replies, at your house. And Bill Pullman says, that's totally crazy, because he's speaking to that same person which claims to be at his same time at his house. And he's telling him, call me. And he's handing him over his phone. Dial your number. And he dials the number, and you see here a little bit of a tattoo on his hand. This is a special sign of in the music. It's like a pause sign, and this actor here, Bill Pullman, is supposed to be a musician in this movie. Yeah, so this is not an occult symbol so far. So he's calling. This is a fermate. Yeah, It's a pause sign. Okay? This is depicted here. Okay. Go ahead. And he's calling himself at his home. And he's then hearing the same voice in the phone. I told you I am here. How did you do that? How did you go into my house? And he says on the phone, it's not my custom to go where I am not wanted. And then he's laughing, and you hear him laughing both on the telephone with a little bit of time delay and in reality when he was standing in front of him, give me back my phone. Yeah, that's actually it. And the people don't get it. What's meant by that? Because is he dreaming? Is he hallucinating? Is whatever? What is it there? What's it about? It's so strange. And then as this mystery man disappears, the music fades in, people are moving, and everything is going back to normal. Yeah, what's the meaning behind? Yeah, it's quite obvious. It's quite obvious, because you see that he's approaching him after he took drugs. The music fades out. So he's in another mental state now. Yeah, he does not see the other people. He's just constantly focusing him. Yeah, you see eye to eye contact. He's only approaching after he took drugs. So the drug, the alcohol in that matter here in that film, can go then. What else? Elevates you into another level. Yeah. Then you can be approached by the so-called mystery man. And I think that you.
I wouldn't say elevation, Michael. Yeah. I would say it's more of a depressant. So it's actually you're going down to the pit, so to speak, to speak to someone closer to Satan.
Another mental state you're being more responsive to things. Yeah, let's put it that way. You're being responsive to things. You open up some areas which are usually not been
accessible. Been,
accessible. Yeah, correct. Yeah, right. Thank you for helping me out, brother. Yes. Yeah.
Sure. No, that's very true when you're under the influence of whatever, you know.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. So imagine all these stars which we came across. Phil Collins is using joints. David Bowie is using cocaine. There are several others which are, David Bowie is also most probably using heroin for his heroes. And so many other people, think about Whitney Houston, think about so many people who are into drugs and also this stuff. And alcohol is quite usual for the average guy, for the average John Doe on the street. Alcohol, okay, yeah, good. I drink my beers and not another beer. And you see that you're getting into being an addict quite soon. And you see that the major thing here is actually this, he's in his home. Yeah. So after he drank his portion of the alcohol, yeah, and he's in another mental state. Yeah. And that's the case when he enters his home. Yeah. He's entering him. He's allowing to be entered by an evil spirit by being into a drug abuse state. This is my explanation for that. And I can back that up by the next thing.
Well, yeah, right. Because alcohol is called spirits too. You know, you go
correct. Yeah.
Different places that say spirits, you know, well, it's, they're speaking of selling alcohol and not just something like a glass of wine. No,
of course not.
Much more potent, hard alcohol. It's, you know, I was kind of shocked, but I guess I shouldn't be, because, you know, part of this lockdown or whatever you want to call it that the world is going through right now. Here in the United States where I live, they have all of the liquor stores open. Gee, why is that? People have to have their liquor. Yeah.
They
encourage it.
Yeah. He actually the point is here, he's telling him, you know, this is totally crazy, but actually he's meaning he cannot get it, he cannot grasp it. Yeah, he does know what it means to be entered by another spirit. And you see that you are living in a satanic world when people who were driving under the influence are having mitigating circumstances. I hope that's the correct thing. I'm looking that up on my smartphone at the moment. Yeah, at court, when they are having hurt or have had an accident, yeah, they are better off when they have used drugs than not. You see that this is very satanic. So I hope you get the point. Yeah, you see, if you are in a correct mental state, and then you are causing an accident and hurting someone, and making damage, yeah, then you are being fully responsible for that. But if you are under the influence, yeah, then you're not fully responsible for that, and you are far better off. Yeah, you see, this is satanic. This is really satanic. So if you are using drugs, you are better off because you don't have to. You're getting not that much of trouble at the court. That cannot be correct. This cannot absolutely be correct, because as you are a grown old man, you have to be grown. You have to be adult to get your driver's license. Yeah, and then you should know that you don't have to drive under the influence. But if you do, you're better off at court. This is not a Christian logic. This is not logic at all. This is just for me, that's another purpose, that to say, okay, this is a satanic world out there. If you are using influences, if you are using drugs, yeah, and you are better off, yeah, because it makes absolutely no sense. But the bottom line here is actually this: call your number. Yeah, so you are just a number. You're not an individual anymore. You're just a number. Call yourself. Yeah, call your number. Call your home. Yeah, connect yourself to your mental state. Connect yourself to your conscience, whatever. So, and he is telephone. Yeah, and what does he say? I hope I can get it here. Call me. Call me, like Blondie, huh? Debbie Harry, call me. To call a pagan god, call me. This is a phrase, this is a code, if you like to say so. Call me, yeah, and telephone, yeah. This
call
is a phrase.
Call unto me, as you say.
Sorry?
Call unto me.
Yeah, also, yeah.
Like worshipping, yeah?
Yeah, worship me. Yeah.
Oh.
Worship me. Worship me.
Call unto me. That's why he entered his home. He said, I usually don't come where I'm not welcome.
Right.
Yeah, that comes later
that
on.
Was,
yeah,
that was the translation. No, you said that. Yeah. You said that earlier already. You said, "I don't ever. It is not my custom to go where I'm not wanted.
Yeah.
Where I'm not wanted." And I said, "Well, I'm not welcome. Welcome has quite a different meaning.
Yeah.
Because you have to welcome familiar spirits." Right?
Mm-hmm. There we go.
Because if you are in the spirit of Jesus Christ, he cannot enter.
He cannot enter.
He can only enter there. This is a double negotiation. It is not my custom to go where I'm not wanted. Meaning, it is my custom to go where I am wanted or welcomed.
Right.
Yeah.
People who put up their spirits open to my spirit, like using drugs.
Yeah.
Whether alcohol or any other drug.
Yes.
Yes.
Because that's like in Revelation, people got drunk by the wine of her fornication.
Yeah.
And when you get drunk, you don't think straight anymore.
Yeah. But you will be rewarded in this world.
Yeah, in this world.
Yeah, of course. In the material world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But at least right. I think we all can agree on the fact that we are spirits in a material world.
Yep, and I think we need to end it because we've been going quite a long session today, and this is great. Great to have both of you along, and I'm really looking forward to getting on with more of these sessions in the Satanic Media Agenda Exposed. So I'm ready to go. Well, how about you, Michael and Jörg?
Well, when I have the time, I would like to join you, but, you know, I don't always have the time. But for the moment, I'm unemployed. I got all the time in the world.
Right. Right. So
we could team up tomorrow or what else, whenever you're available.
Right. That's what we're looking at doing. So sounds great.
Instead of sun worshiping.
Yeah. Well, yeah, the world is a troubled place all of a sudden, you know, out of nowhere. And it's in the cards, in the agenda of the Antichrist to put us through these types of scenarios so they can gather more information and learn, how to conduct and control and manipulate the people to believe a lie better and better, more and more subtle as we go, and under the guise of health and well-being. Nothing new under the sun. This has happened before in history with the 1918 Spanish flu, I believe it was called, after World War II or World War I, excuse me. And so they're trying to push this as a reality. And I don't think the three of us buy it too well, do we?
because the Spanish flu isn't originated from Spain also.
No.
It's just that we know what this is all about. This is just an agenda. It's the same agenda they followed with 9/11. There they did it only contained to the United States of America, and now they do it all over the world. You know, when they want to abolish the cash system, when they want to abolish private laws or privacy laws all over the world, you know, the privacy sphere and everything but that, or when they want to start a war, there's always someone to blame. Politicians are to blame. Economists are to blame. The economy is to blame, whatever. But now we have this virus. And they tell you, well, you don't have to use cash anymore because cash money is spreading the virus. So abolish cash money. And everybody shouts out.
You are to blame. See how he does it? You are to blame. All of you little people.
So the point is, they are pushing their agenda very hard right now. And the world is never going to be the same. The world never was the same again after 9/11. And the world will never be the same after the 17th of March, where Corona really got worldwide attention with lockdowns all over the world, here in Belgium, Germany, all over Europe. And that's something that we have to get used to. And, people can say, Jörg, you're crazy. Or they can say, well, if we always said the devil knows he has but a little time. He is really, how do you say that?
Opening all gates.
All gates of the flood. Yeah. No, he is really tightening the thumb screws.
Yes.
You
know? Yes.
That's what he's doing right now, and they won't be loosened anymore. It's only getting harder and harder. It's not getting looser anymore. No way anymore. There's no way back. There is no way back. So when you're in this world, I tell you, you're lost. But if you have the peace with what Jesus made you free, they can do nothing to you. And this is why I see this coronavirus for the moment. You maybe laugh with me or not. I see it as a blessing. I get unemployment money. I don't have to work. I can stay at home all day, and I can work for the Lord all day and still be paid and pay my bills. That's how I see it. To me, it is a blessing in a certain way. Until the thumbscrews are that hard that I can't participate anymore. Revelation chapter 13. He will cause everybody, free and bond, rich and poor, to take the mark of the beast. What is the mark of the beast? Well, they will have bio-identification through your iris in the eye. Huh? You see the prominent eyes in the picture here? They will have iris recognition. They will have fingerprint recognition. They don't even need a chip in your body anymore.
Right, biometrics.
They use these biometrics. They take everything they need and they put it in a quote-unquote cloud or whatever. And whether you get your social points and you are allowed to do things or you don't get your social points and you're not allowed to do things. You refuse to take a vaccine, you're out of the system. You refuse to take the cashless money system, you're out of the system. And that's what they're going to do. Everybody who is not with us is against us, as George W. Bush said. And Donald Trump said, we are fighting the invisible enemy. And that's exactly what we are doing, fighting the invisible enemy. This quote-unquote virus is an invisible enemy. And that's what they are, of course, not telling you. But the people all over the world are screaming for solutions. Well, Hegelian dialectic, problem, action, solution. That's right. What we are facing, you know?
Yep, that sums it up.
So thanks for inviting me. I got to go and see you next time.
Thanks, Jörg. Thank you, Michael.
Yeah, thank you, Brett. Thank you, dear listeners. Sorry for my English today.
It was perfectly well, brother. Perfectly well.
There's some very hard phrases which you don't.
In German, yeah.
Which you don't use very often. So I have to look that up sometime.
That's true. Mm. But we appreciate all the effort, Michael, and trying to do this in English. I know it's
also to do it a little bit more generally. You see, it's not restricted on David Bowie or whatever. It's just the same thing around. But people were very sleepyheads, not to recognize the threat beforehand, and most of them are caught quite unaware. They could never expect that 4 weeks ago, the things which are now happening here.
That's true.
Never expect that.
Well, and that's a thing, Michael, you know, that I had the same problem years ago. I didn't understand much at all about the workings of, you know, the satanic system that is imposing itself down on mankind at the moment. And I had to just really take a break from normal activities to study things a little bit, even to get a small grasp on, you know, where these things are headed. What's the future? What's in store for the future in the flesh, you know? That's one thing, but what's in store in the future in the spirit is another. It's completely different and completely isolated. And that's why our time with the Lord is very precious. Our time spent reading scriptures, studying and reflecting on our own lives, our own struggles. It's very precious because we are in a battle against flesh and blood, against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. Mm. And we know Christ will prevail through all of it. We know that. So the point is to be with Christ and not with this world, because this world is certainly passing away quickly. Mm-hmm.
Okay, then thanks for stepping in. Thanks for tuning in. God bless. Read your Bible and Maranatha.